Venezuela crisis. U.S. planes carrying aid arrive in Colombia. U.S. military planes carrying humanitarian aid for Venezuela have arrived in the Colombian border town of Cúcuta. The aid is being stockpiled at the request of the Venezuelan opposition leader, Juan Guaidó, who declared himself interim president last month. President Nicolas Maduro has alleged the aid is part of a U.S. plot. Mr. Guaidó says Venezuelan volunteers will carry it across the border on 23 February. Speaking at a news conference in Cúcuta, a U.S. aid administrator, Mark Green, said the aid had been requested by Mr. Guaidó because Venezuela was in the grip of a growing humanitarian crisis. Children are going hungry, and nearly every hospital in Venezuela is experiencing serious medicine shortages. He said the crisis had reached regional proportions, with 3 million Venezuelans migrating to neighboring countries in search of food and medicine. Today we are standing on the front lines of one of the largest displacements of people in the history of Latin America. A representative for Mr. Guaidó said more collection points for aid were being opened up in Brazil and the Caribbean. He said meetings would take place with the Brazilian government this week to organize details of storage facilities in the Brazilian state of Roraima on the border with Venezuela. He added that aid was being stockpiled in Miami to be flown to the Dutch territory of Curaçao early next week. It remains unclear if the aid will be allowed to enter Venezuela. Video.
As we sit here, there is U.S. aid across the border in Colombia, waiting to be brought across. We have met many people here who tell us they are desperately in need of aid. Why not allow it through?
Primero que es un show que ha montado el gobierno de Estados Unidos con la complacencia del gobierno colombiano para tratar de humillar a los venezolanos. Venezuela es un país que tiene su capacidad para satisfacer las necesidades de nuestro pueblo. Venezuela es un país que tiene los problemas que puede tener cualquier otro país y que estamos en una lucha desde hace muchos años, una lucha exitosa por reducir la pobreza, la miseria. Venezuela es un país que tiene dignidad y los Estados Unidos ha pretendido montarnos una crisis humanitaria para justificar una intervención militar humanitaria. Y esto es parte de ese show. Por eso nosotros por dignidad le decimos a la mendicidad, a las migajas que ellos pretenden traer con una comida intoxicada, con una comida de sobra que tienen, le decimos no, Venezuela tiene dignidad. Venezuela produce, trabaja y nuestro pueblo no necesita ser mendigo de nadie.
President Nicolas Maduro has called the operation a U.S. orchestrated show and denies there is any crisis. On Friday he ordered the military to remain on high alert against what he described as U.S. war plans. Mr. Guaidó, who has been recognized by the U.S. and most Western governments as interim president of Venezuela, said hundreds of thousands of volunteers had signed up to create brigades to help get the aid into the country. He repeated his call to the Venezuelan military to allow the aid to go through. But it is unclear if they will do so. The message we have to get through to the armed forces is that they have 1 week to do the right thing. He has set 23 February as the date for the humanitarian aid to get moving. Officials in Cúcuta said additional aid flights would be arriving in Colombia over the coming hours and days. A statement said medical supplies and pharmaceuticals meant for use in hospitals will arrive early next week. A road bridge between Venezuela and Colombia remains blocked on the Venezuelan side by shipping containers. Video.
The U.S. and Venezuela share history that goes back centuries. A Pew Research poll in 2014 found that 62% of Venezuelans had a favorable opinion of the U.S., but their leaders haven't always seen eye to eye. So how did it go from this?
Mr. Kennedy is the first U.S. president to visit Venezuela.
To this?
We have many options for Venezuela, including a possible military option.
To understand the relationship between Venezuela and the U.S., you have to know that it mainly revolves around one precious resource, oil. The first oil wells were drilled in the early 20th century, and by 1940, Venezuela became the third largest producer of crude oil in the world. From the beginning, American companies were heavily involved. And the U.S. also bought the majority of the country's oil. And in 1961, John F. Kennedy made the first official visit of a U.S. president to Venezuela.
Liberty and economic progress go hand in hand.
Here's Jackie Kennedy delighting the crowd with a few words of Spanish. The Cold War, oil, and trade set the tone for decades of friendship. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, Venezuela backed the US against its Caribbean neighbor, and in the 60s and 70s, the country experienced an oil bonanza. Thousands of US oil workers and businessmen took their families to live in Venezuela and work in their oil fields. With them, they brought American culture, food, fashion. Venezuelans lapped up all things American, and the country became one of the most dependable markets for US consumer goods. But not everyone was such a fan of the US. During this whole time, there was always a large part of the population that was against the influence of the superpower. And despite the huge oil boom, large sections of society remained poor. All the while, the pro-US political elite in the country grew richer. This anger spilled out into the streets and built up until 1998, when Hugo Chavez was elected president in a landslide victory. In the beginning, Chavez wasn't that anti-American firebrand he later became. Washington cautiously welcomed the new leader and adopted a wait-and-see attitude. That all changed in 2002, when a military coup overthrew Chavez for 48 hours. He was convinced that the US was behind the plot. Today, though, we know that American officials knew about the coup beforehand and had contact with some of its leaders. This was enough to change Chavez and Venezuela's relationship with the US from then on. This was Chavez talking the day after President George Bush Jr. at the UN.
Yesterday, the devil came here.
En este mismo lugar,
right here.
Huele a azufre todavía.
And it smells of sulfur still today.
He kept up the rhetoric with President Obama too.
Farsante, Obama. Eres un farsante.
But despite the war of words and Chavez's friendliness with some of America's biggest enemies, the oil and trade between the two countries kept flowing. Until now. After Chavez died in 2013, successor and so-called son, Nicolás Maduro, took over. The US saw him as an autocrat who let Venezuelans starve and oversaw hyperinflation, record murder rates, and political isolation. The US began imposing sanctions on Mr. Maduro and his government. Donald Trump has even used Venezuela's socialist model as a way to attack his opponents.
The Democrats want to turn America into Venezuela. That'll be wonderful. That'll be wonderful.
Things came to a head in 2019 when the US recognized Juan Guaido, the head of the National Assembly, as the new president of Venezuela after allegations of electoral fraud. In response, Maduro broke off diplomatic relations with the US and vowed to hang on to power. It's clear that the relations between Venezuela and the US have reached a new low. But can both countries really get by without the other? With America still the dominant superpower in the region and Venezuela having the largest proven oil reserves in the world, this doesn't seem to be the end of the story.
British billionaire Richard Branson is organizing a pop concert on 22 February in Calcutta to be live-streamed over the internet to raise funds for more aid.